Hi guys, thanks for tuning in to another video episode on ForgottenWeapons.com. I'm Ian, and today we are here taking a look at a Swedish rifle. In fact, the first Swedish semi-auto rifle, the AG-42 Ljungman. Hopefully I'm pronouncing that right. These were developed in 1942, hence the AG-42 name, because Sweden decided that with the war going on, all the cool kids were getting semi-auto rifles, and maybe they should do it too. So the development process on the AG-42 was actually surprisingly and really impressively quick. It took about a year for this gun to go from concept to full-on production. Almost all of these were manufactured in 1943. And they are an interesting operating system that we don't see, well, there aren't a whole lot of guns that use it, but the one most common one, the M16, is all over the place today. This is a direct gas impingement rifle, meaning that Eric Eklund, the designer, the engineer who designed it, did away with the whole idea of having a gas piston or any other mechanism that would physically move to get gas from the muzzle down to the operating parts. Instead, this has just an open tube. There's a vent from the barrel into a gas tube, and the gas tube runs directly to this little port. And gas pressure here pushes directly on the bolt carrier to cycle it back. So there is no piston. There are no moving parts to this operating system, which in theory makes it both very simple, idiot-proof, and contributes to a higher level of accuracy because there are fewer moving parts on the rifle. We can take a closer look at this. We have a cutaway. This isn't a Ljungman, but this is an Egyptian copy, which is functionally identical. And you can see, right here in the barrel, there's a gas port cut. The Egyptian version has a gas regulator, which the Swedish version didn't require. There's a lot more varying condition in sand and dirt in Egypt. In Sweden, there wasn't a whole lot of opportunity to get into that sort of terrain, and it was decided that an adjustable gas system was an unnecessary complication. Anyway, we have gas vented off the barrel here through this tube directly back to the bolt or bolt carrier. So as far as locking mechanism, the Ljungman and this Egyptian copy use a tilting bolt, very similar to what we will later find in the FAL, very similar to the Tokarev rifle, where the back end of the bolt has a locking lug on it, and when it's fully in battery, that locking lug drops down. You can see it right here. When I pull the bolt back, it lifts up. When the bolt's fully in battery, it drops down slightly. And that's what locks the gun open. So specifically, when you see reference to these, this is an AG-42B. These were modified in the early 1950s with a number of improvements that had been decided upon during the 10 years the rifle was in service. Because these went into service so very quickly, it's really not all that surprising that they decided there were a number of things that had to be improved. The first of them, one of the more obvious ones, is these two odd lumps on the cover assembly. What these are for, this is part of the Ljungman's kind of odd operating system. In order to close the bolt, now I have an empty magazine in this which will lock it open, so I'll take the magazine out for a minute. In order to close the bolt, we push it forward slightly and snap it back. There is no handle on this bolt. There's no way to grab it and pull it back other than just kind of pressure with your fingers, which isn't how it's meant to work. If the gun is closed and you want to lock it open, you grab this cover, push it all the way forward, you hear that snap, it locks onto the bolt, and then we can pull it back. At this point, the recoil spring is tightened up in between the bolt inside here and the bolt carrier. So the spring's at full tension right now. And this allows me to pull the bolt back. I can load via stripper clip if the gun's empty, or work on the gun, pull out an empty case, whatever I need to do. When I tap this all the way back on the back of the receiver here, that unlocks the bolt from the cover and it snaps forward. And if you think an M1 will eat your thumb, this is about the worst gun out there for crushing your finger in. Because a lot of people don't expect that, don't see it coming. You stick your thumb in there, you're gonna be in a world of hurt. So it was the first model of the AG-42 didn't have these nubs on the cover. It just had a pair of slightly serrated flat sections. And they realized that when you're up in the Swedish winter and cold and gloves and fatigue, that's really not effective to grab onto. So they added these two lugs so that you have something that you can actually get a good grip on. They added this rubber buffer. That's there just to preserve brass, so that when brass comes out, it bounces off this rubber buffer and isn't deformed, so it can be collected and reloaded easily. The 42B, they also added these gas vents to act as a muzzle brake at the end of the barrel. These were not there on the original M42 rifle. And they had had some trouble with soldiers accidentally ejecting magazines, because originally there was simply a locking catch on the back of the magazine. So they added this front locking lug as well. So now you can see the regular magazine catch at the back. You also, to remove the magazine, have to press in on this forward hook. So these were another one of those early semi-auto guns where the magazine was detachable, but that was mainly for ease of cleaning and maintenance. And soldiers didn't carry spare magazines. They carried stripper clips to reload the gun. So it wasn't all that essential to be able to remove the magazine quickly. It was more important to make the magazine secure so it couldn't be accidentally lost. There were a few internal improvements in the trigger on the M42B, and that pretty much covers it. The lugs, the buffer, the magazine, and the muzzle brake. Unfortunately, well, fortunately for the Swedes, they did an extremely thorough job of upgrading their 42s to the 42B configuration. And original unconverted guns are very rare out there. We don't have one in our reference collection, but we do have the upgraded model, which is what you commonly see. These are actually very comfortable guns to fire. They're all chambered in 6.5 by 55 Swede, not surprisingly. Recoil's not too bad. They're fairly accurate guns. The rear sight is interesting and well designed, well thought out. It has a range adjustment here that tells you how far out you're going. This is kind of similar to an M1 or similar to what you'd see on a Bren gun. So I can click this out to 700 yards. One other thing you'll notice, if we can zoom in there, there's a little triangle right next to the range marker. That indicates that this sight is set for pointed bullets, Spitzer bullets. Originally, the 6.5 Swede used a round nose cartridge. And when the sights are set for round nose, you'll have a rounded picture, basically a picture of a round nose bullet. So that's on there so the soldier can make sure he's got the correct type of ammunition for the rifle. Disassembly of these guns is actually pretty simple. Take out the magazine. We'll snap the bolt forward. And then we start disassembly by pulling the cover slightly forward. This is the safety lever back here. This is fire. Switching it over is safe. To disassemble, we put it halfway in the middle, and we can lift up this whole piece. This comes out. You can see when I'm rotating that lever, I'm moving this bottom piece, which acts as the safety. Then the cover plate comes off. We have our recoil spring attached here, and you can also see this little hook. This is what actually catches the bolt inside. So when you drop this back against this piece, what happens is this hook is pressed in like this, and that releases the bolt to go forward. Same thing when you push this forward over the bolt, this spring piece lifts up and snaps in place, and that's what holds onto the bolt. And we can, speaking of the bolt, pull the bolt out. Once you've got this rear piece off the receiver, everything just slides out the back very easily. So our bolt and bolt carrier. Get this back in place. Act like this. And you can see this is the locking lug on the bolt. So this is locked in place. Hammer hits the firing pin right here. And when the gun cycles backwards, the bolt drops and allows the bolt to retract. Anyone familiar with the FAL or the Tokarev will certainly recognize this system. And lastly, on the bolt carrier, we have a small cup here, and this is what gas from the barrel comes into. So this slips nicely over this nipple on the front of the receiver, catches gas pressure, pushes everything back when it fires. So, really a very simple firearm, especially with the direct gas impingement system. The Swedes actually didn't use these for very long. They didn't make a whole lot of them. They were a bit susceptible to cold weather. Frankly, they were susceptible like almost any semi-automatic rifle is. When the lubricants get very cold, they get stiff, the guns don't function as reliably. So a number of these were made and were issued. Ultimately, the Swedes basically went back to using bolt-action Mausers for a time after adopting the 42. Eventually, when they finally totally replaced the Mausers, they were using the HKG-3 and the FN-FNC rifles. But that wouldn't be until the 60s and 70s that those were fully adopted. In the meantime, this was, in fact, the first functional, large-scale production rifle that used direct gas impingement, which makes it an interesting historical piece. And they're just neat rifles. You don't see a whole lot of them out there. One other element worth knowing for those of you who have these rifles and want to shoot them without crushing your thumb, the safety actually also disengages the bolt release. So if we look back here, we talked about the little spring-loaded latch that holds the bolt into the bolt into this top cover. That's it right there. Now, if we come around and look at the other side of this rear piece, you can see when I have the rifle set on fire, we have a block of metal here, and that's what that hook impinges on when we slam it back. If I put the rifle into safe, you can now see that this is hollow and open. So when I bring the bolt assembly back, there's nothing to hit that little spring latch, and the bolt won't go flying forward. So if you're cleaning the gun without disassembling it, or if you want to reload the gun and make sure you're not going to slam the bolt on anything, put the rifle in safe, and then do your operations, and then you can switch it back to fire, and it'll function again. Thanks for watching. I hope you've learned something, and tune back into ForgottenWeapons.com for more information on interesting firearms.